You know, one of the things that Jane Gamora mentions in her book, and others have mentioned, is that, you know, because, and perhaps because, after the war, people came back. A lot of the, people had to get back to work, but many of the Nisei were still young. A lot of the active members of the temple were students. Students don't have a lot of money. And the finances of the temple were, I've heard, a number of people say, were a little bit dicey back then. And they couldn't really afford a full-time minister. So Reverend Imamura never served as a full-time minister here. In fact, he started out as a part-time minister, and he had a part-time job at UC Berkeley as a janitor for a number of years. And then he got a job as a curator in the Department of Anthropology, where he worked for a great number of years. So it's kind of interesting when you think about that, that the bazaar started out as a, through Reverend Imamura's urging, be a YBA fundraiser, and then they blew it at the beach. But, but then it grew into the main fundraising activity for our temple. And so that's a great history. It's a great thing to know about our temple. Moving on to the new temple, as you know then, this temple was growing, and it started bursting the old temple at the seams. And so there was plans being made to build a new temple. The architectural plans were drawn by Harry and George Nakahara. They were church members. They were architects. They donated their services when they designed this building. Mrs. Oda talks about Harry Nakahara in particular in her talk. This is what Mrs. Oda recalled. She said, around 1950, with membership growing, increasing need for a larger temple was evident. Betty Nakahara's husband, Harry, was an architect. He was asked to head up the project. He designed it in conjunction with Reverend Imamura and Jane's idea of a temple of the future for the generation now reaching maturity. Reverend and Jane had always thought of the need for a temple for the future young people and foresaw the coming need for an American Buddhist temple. Hence, the design is different from the traditional. So it was designed for our children and for children to come. At first, it was hard for the older people to accept it, but as time went on, I feel that it has become ours, the now and the future. Harry declined any payment for his work and all the many hours he spent designing the temple and overseeing the construction. I'm grateful to Harry and the Nakahara family for their forever donation. And so, her words are really, really beautiful in talking about the sort of spirit that everyone had, joining together and helping out, donating their time, their work, their expertise to allow our temple to grow. And as all of you know, our Onaijin here is quite unique among Buddhist temples in America and maybe around the world. Most Jodo Shinshu temples, if you've been to them, you know they're quite ornate. There's lots of gold, there's lots of lanterns, there's many portraits, there's all these other tables, all these things, and they're all important. They all have great symbolic significance. But the decision was made at our temple by Reverend and Mrs. Imamura and the members to have an idea of an altar which is very simple and yet had a deep sense, a sense of deep, serenity. And I think they accomplished what they were looking for in our own idea. I know I've talked to many people who've grown up at the temple. They kind of thought this was the normal. This was the norm growing up. And so when they went to other temples, they go, whoa, what is this? But it's interesting, to get both reactions. When people from other temples come, when they've grown up going to other more traditional temples, they come here and they go, whoa, what is this? And so it takes a little while to get used to it. And as Mrs. Oda said, some of the older members, it sounds, weren't very happy about this design when it first was proposed. But after these years, many years, since our temple was constructed back in the early 50s, this is our temple now. And I think we all feel this is the way it needs to be. This is how it is, and this is how it needs to be. As many of you know, this is a story that we've told on other occasions. When this temple was being designed, and the design for the altar was being proposed, the one item that was the most important item was this, would be a gohonzon, a central object of reverence, the statue of Amida. At the time, there was none. there was a writing, Namo Amida Butsu, a scroll in Chinese, but there was no statue, and it was felt that a statue would be appropriate for religious purposes, perhaps also for design purposes. And so Mrs. Matsuura was sent to Japan. I guess she was in Hawaii at the time with one of her kids, and the temple elders said, I think her son-in-law said, please go to Japan and find us a nice Buddha. And so she went to Japan, and according to the story, she looked all over the place and couldn't find the right statue. But there was a minister over there, his name was Reverend Ashikaga Joen Ashikaga, and he knew of the Berkeley Temple, he knew of the U.S., and he knew of Mrs. Matsuura's search. And so he approached her, and the rest is history. Let me read about that in another book that I'd like to introduce you to. This book is called Higan, The Compassionate Vow. This was written by Mrs. Shinobu Matsuura, who is the mother of Jane Imamura. Okay? This is a book, this is a compilation of her diaries and her writings that she penned throughout her life. Okay? And in one of the chapters, she talks about that when she encountered Reverend Ashikaga and she was given the statue. Let me just read a little bit from that portion, if you don't mind. Anyway, so she had been looking all over couldn't find the right one. I was perplexed as how I was to meet the one Gohonzon for Berkeley. Some images were small in stature, others were tall. Some were bright and new, others darkened with age. Some were very costly. After bowing to countless Buddhas, I thoroughly realized how difficult it was to complete this search. Reverend Ashikaga wrote in the Jisho later, I wish that, even in a dream, someone would come forward and say, I shall take full responsibility and wait for you. When I was at a loss, Joen Sensei kindly revealed to me that the Amida image he had personally lived with for many years was the Buddha with a long and rich history. At that time, the Buddha was enshrined on the Ikuno Island in Hiroshima. He invited me to go visit the island to meet the Buddha. Okay, let me just jump ahead here. She talks a little bit about Ikuno Island. This was a tiny little island in the inland sea off of Hiroshima. And just before the war and during the war, apparently Reverend Ashikaga was instrumental in starting a Buddhist colony, peace colony there, on the island. And many people who were followers of Pure Land Buddhism joined him at the time. It was a really well thought out plan. They had their own industry. They grew herbs and other crops that they sold to maintain the colony. And the central part of the community was something called the Heiwa Kaikan, the Hall of Peace. And it was in that Hall of Peace that this Buddha image was enshrined. Okay, this Buddha image belonged to the Ashikaga family. They had enshrined it there. Let me just read it. She talks about Ikuno Island. This small island is in the Seto Island Sea. Historically, it was known for the ancient stone caskets and other prehistoric relics. It is also thought that those who lost in the battles between the Genji and the Heikei sought refuge on this island. But more recently, it was a desolate and uninhabited island until about 10 years ago, when Ashikaga Sensei and his followers moved here. Through hardship, they cultivated the mountain, working in such harmony and peace that word of their unique community spread. Japanese repatriates, homeless and weary of war, came from Manchuria and other countries, seeking peace at Ashikaga Sensei's side. A community grew, a school was built, electricity was generated, and for community activities, the Heiwa Kaikan was built. Today, the island is known as a utopian village of over 140 families. Being productive, they became well known for their harvest of tangerines and sweet potatoes.